Chairman, I want to hold all bills before the study, please.
All right, Vice Chair Costa moves to hold the four remaining bills for the study. That's seconded by Representative Canario. All in favor?
Okay.
Is there any opposition? Okay, those four bills will be held for further study, at least for now. Thank you.
This bill is the second time I've sponsored it. Last year we adjourned rather abruptly, and it didn't get an opportunity for a vote. It is nicknamed the Good Samaritan Bill. I'm not sure I think it accurately reflects what I think the purpose of this bill is. But it falls into a couple of categories. Having been a former prosecutor, who signed, by the way, a few of those deferred sentence agreements, which I feel guilty about because I told those people that, oh, yeah, your record will be expunged as soon as you finish this. That must have been like 25 years ago. I have a feeling they have a dot board that they're throwing with my picture on it, you know. But from a prosecutor's perspective, your job is to enforce the law, to take a case that you feel as though meets the standard of the burden of proof beyond a reasonable doubt and prosecute that to the full extent of the law. On the other hand, we have an epidemic in heroin use, an epidemic. Epidemic can be described in many ways, but hundreds of people are dying because of this in Rhode Island, hundreds. If it was a matter that the Center for Disease Control was in charge of, I can assure you we would have people up here with the white suits on and doing their job. How does this Good Samaritan bill affect both of those objectives or concerns? Well, the law, and I could speak again with my lawyer hat on, the law engages frequently in balancing tests. Oftentimes, especially Supreme Court decisions, you will see the Supreme Court balance competing interests, a deprivation or an infringement on one's constitutional right versus public safety. Well, I think that this bill balances two interests, the interest of the prosecutor and the prosecutor's office, the Attorney General's office, to prosecute cases, and the fact that this bill will give someone who is on probation, on parole, or may have engaged in criminal activity that arises out of a circumstance where someone is in need of emergency care, and as I learned last year, and some of the folks that are present here today, I got to speak to afterwards, I get to learn about the miracle drug called Narcan, where it literally saves someone's life to the point where one could say it's a miracle drug. Someone is unconscious on death's doorstep. You administer a dose of Narcan, and bang, for 30 minutes, they can be stabilized, gotten to a hospital, given the treatment that they need, and save a life. So here's the balancing test. The balancing test is, do we enforce every crime that the law dictates, or do we save a life? I don't think there's any balancing going on there. I think the issue is we always err on the side of saving a life. And if there's a chance that that 911 call can be made and that that person might be aware of what I hope we do at some point in time in this hearing this evening, and hopefully before the month is over, vote on and pass this bill and have the governor sign it, as the Senate has. If we can pass the word so that a similarly situated person in a situation that has yet to happen, it's happened many times in the past, but has yet to happen, that person can know that I'm not going to get in trouble and that my interest, my selfish interest, I don't want to get myself in trouble, will not be a counterbalance to doing the right thing, calling 911, getting someone's assistance so that a dose of Narcan can be administered and this person's life can be saved. I think put in that context, this is a no-brainer. It saves lives. And to save a life, we give people medals for that. So I believe that this bill outlines the problem of the concerns of that person who might be debating whether I should pick up the phone. It does provide the Attorney General under certain circumstances to pursue a prosecution that might result in a murder case, but not as a result of any facts involved in the transaction, as I'll refer to it, that's going on at that moment. It will save lives, and it will address the concerns of the law enforcement community and the Attorney General's office. And I would urge my fellow members to ask as many questions, but I know a lot about this subject matter. I think I'm the only former prosecutor here on the dais as a voting member of the House. But I would urge a passage, Mr. Chairman. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Bob, so basically, I'm with you on this bill. There's no question at all with me on this at all.
Yep.
At all. Actually, it's about time, but it is what it is. So, but there's still a small factor in there where a person can be prosecuted. Is that what you're saying?
But not from the facts that are, if I can, like, create a hypothetical situation. There's an apartment, someone has taken a drug, maybe the person that can call 911 has delivered that drug to them or given it to them or shared it with them or sold it to them. Then any facts that arises out of that situation cannot be used against them if they pick up the phone and call 911 and at least allow healthcare people to attempt to save their lives. There may be other facts and other circumstances out there that are extraneous to the transaction or what was going on in that apartment that could be used against them in a violation hearing or if a death resulted in a murder case, but not anything that happens in that apartment. That's they get a pass. They get immunity.
Is the evidence that we're talking about that is not admissible or the charges that can't be brought strictly related to the evidence that is found on premise and this doesn't act as the fruit of a poisonous tree? If there's some other crime which is revealed based upon evidence found at the crime scene, can that other crime be pursued and charged if it wouldn't have been revealed absent the police coming to this scene?
Well, it would be,
if I'm being clear.
I think I know. It's transactional immunity. So if they went in and found a bazooka that was connected to a terrorist plot, that wouldn't be allowed to be used because the only reason they went there was because the call was made. And when I say they went there, these are healthcare. This is the rescue that's going to come or, you know, someone of that nature would come. So it's not going to be the police responding. This is going to be a 911 call. And I don't think typically the police respond to a request for emergency services. But the transaction itself, what's going on in that apartment and what the police, assuming the police do come, what they view or see, that would not be able to be used against them. No. If they had a connection to it, obviously.
For any crime, not just those relating to possession or distribution of narcotics?
I think that the bill refers to the possession, distribution. The AG will say that it's very broad. I do understand that there's a broadness and that some defense lawyer is going to try to make an interpretation of how broad that exemption spreads out to. I don't believe that that's the intent of the bill, but it's to give someone complete immunity from anything they did involving drug use, drug possession, drug sales, that involves the persons in that room, not that they sold drugs 4 weeks ago or 2 weeks later, but rather that transaction, they will be free from immunity. Yeah. I mean, free from prosecution.
So if, suppose hypothetically there's human trafficking going on at the same place that there's a drug den, if you will.
Determine whether
trafficking would still be subject to prosecution. If I read this correctly, I want to make
correct.
Sure.
Correct.
Yeah, right.
Thank you.
Right. Representative Flippy, if I can hop in. If you look at 2128.94, it talks about any person who in good faith without malice and in the absence of evidence of an intent to defraud. So if you're trying to use this statute as a scapegoat, then you could still get prosecuted. Seeks medical assistance for someone experiencing a drug overdose or other drug-related medical emergency shall not be charged or prosecuted for any crime related to the possession of a controlled substance or drug paraphernalia or the operation of a drug-involved premise if the evidence for the charge was gained as a result of seeking medical assistance. So it's very limited in its scope.
It is truly a pleasure to be here today to speak about House Bill 7003, the Good Samaritan Overdose and Prevention Act of 2016, which the Department of Behavioral Health Care, Developmental Disabilities, and Hospitals fully supports. I would like to thank you, the members of the committee and the staff, for the swiftness in bringing this important bill to a hearing. We at BHDDH appreciate your consideration and certainly hope that the Good Samaritan bill will soon become law. Since becoming the director of BHDDH last year, I have personally heard from many Rhode Islanders whose lives have been torn apart by the disease of addiction and who have lost loved ones to opiate overdose. Their stories are heartbreaking, and they inspire me, along with my staff, to do all we can to stem the ravages of this disease. As co-chair with Dr. Alexander Scott of the Governor's Overdose Prevention and Intervention Task Force, I would like to underscore that the passage of this bill is included in our strategic plan. While it is difficult to determine the actual number of prevented overdose deaths that might be attributable to the effect of a Good Samaritan law, we know that help seeking in a medical emergency must take precedence over drug-related arrest if we are to save lives. The Good Samaritan overdose laws are a suggested strategy to reduce overdose deaths by several entities, including the National Conference of State Legislators and the Office of the National Drug Control Policy. Available evidence suggests that the fear of arrest is a common barrier to calling 911 during an overdose. Fear of police involvement can lead bystanders to delay or forego calling 911, increasing the risk of overdose death. A Washington-based survey suggests that as drug users learn about Good Samaritan laws, they are more likely to call 911 during an overdose, and law enforcement officers in states that have adopted Good Samaritan laws report that these laws have improved citizens' image of law. Initial evidence from other states is positive, with 88% of drug users surveyed indicating that they would be more likely to summon emergency personnel during an overdose as a result of the legal change. The Good Samaritan law plays an important role in reducing stigma, clarifying law enforcement's role in medical emergencies, and encouraging the use of 911 in a drug-related emergency. All 50 states have some form of a Good Samaritan law, and 34 states have laws similar to the one that is before you. As you know, Rhode Island's Good Samaritan law was in effect from 2013 until its sunset last year, and was successful in supporting individuals to call 911 and utilize naloxone when in the presence of a suspected opiate overdose. It is also important to note that of the 244 individuals under the influence of an opiate who arrived at the hospital after 911 was called and received support from a recovery coach, 84% of those have continued recovery treatment or support from a Buddhist-sponsored peer recovery specialist. Naloxone is not the answer to an overdose crisis, but the ability to save lives using it opens doors to the possibility of recovery. The answers to this epidemic lie in prevention and recovery, not in the criminal justice system. We know that These interventions, along with follow-up care, have made a significant difference for many by encouraging them to enter treatment and sustain their recovery. Rhode Island has a lot to be proud of in the area of substance use disorder intervention, and the Good Samaritan bill is essential to that work. As your director, my commitment is to establish a system of care that promotes recovery by providing coordinated services that will meet each individual's needs and help them achieve successful outcomes. We're only able to do that through the thoughtful leadership of all of you and all of us working together with the recovery community. Passage of this bill is a crucial step in that process, so I urge you to pass it swiftly and without delay. Thank you for your time and attention.
Hello. Thank you for giving me the opportunity to say a few words today about this important piece of legislation. We've definitely been looking forward to this. Since I stepped into this role only 9 short months ago, unfortunately, at least 136 people have died of drug overdoses in our state, and we know that that's preventable. We've unfortunately also lost more than 1,000 people to drug overdoses in the last 5 years, and they've come from almost every community in Rhode Island. Overdoses represent a public health crisis that is as urgent as any crises we have ever confronted in Rhode Island in the past. The Good Samaritan Law is an absolutely necessary part of our statewide response. Any paramedic or emergency department doctor will tell you that the chances that someone survives a heart attack depend greatly on how quickly that person receives medical attention. The same holds true when someone is overdosing. The seconds count. And yet, unlike witnesses to heart attacks who don't think twice about calling 911, people who are seeing others overdose sometimes hesitate to make the call to get help. In other instances, they may not even pick up the phone. And one of the reasons why this happens is one common obstacle that people fear being arrested. A piece of legislation that eliminates this fear by granting immunity for crimes like simple drug possession and possession of drug paraphernalia will have an immediate impact, and it will save lives. The second component of the Good Samaritan Law, which grants legal protections to people who administer naloxone, will also have a sizable impact on the overdose crisis in Rhode Island, and we need that. Naloxone works. Narcan, it works. Just last week, 2 police officers in Warwick who had recently received naloxone training administered the drug to someone showing the telltale signs of an overdose and potentially saved his life. I called over to the colonel in Warwick this morning to express appreciation for the leadership and getting those officers trained on naloxone administration. People who use or abuse opioids and people who are around others who do should have naloxone, just like people with allergies should have an EpiPen. And they should have no reluctance to act in an emergency and call 911. As we know, Governor Raimondo speaks regularly about building healthy communities, and I'm in full support of that given my role. So expanding that opportunity so that everyone has a chance to make it in Rhode Island is what we're all about here today. A part of building healthy communities is recognizing that addiction is a disease, and then making sure that the tools and protections we need to comprehensively treat that disease are in place. That means education for healthcare providers and patients, recovery resources in every city and town throughout the state, and it also means making sure that no one is reluctant to act and call 911 when that disease of overdose is on the verge of claiming another life that does not have to be lost. Passing the Good Sam law is a vital step in this direction, and it will be an important complement to the strategies laid out in the strategic plan developed by the Governor's Overdose Prevention and Intervention Task Force that Director Montanaro mentioned and that we co-chair together. I commend the sponsors and the committee for their work and leadership to advance this important piece of legislation, and thank you for pushing it forward. Thank you.
Thank you. Any questions for either of the directors? Representative Almeida.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you both of y'all for testifying. Y'all know I'm with this already, so there's no clandestine operation on this end of the mic. But I noticed that you said that you had contacted Warwick PD, and you said, I'm paraphrasing, thank you for this bill. But have you ever heard from the state police or the attorney general in regarding this bill?
There is support for making sure within the governor's administration for making sure that the Good Sam law is promoted. I haven't spoken specifically with the state police or AG Lead about this bill.
Representative Almeida, we have the committee has received a letter in support by Colonel O'Donnell. Whoa. And a letter
got it too.
Yep, with in support with some reservations from the Attorney General's office.
Well, the way I look at it, I see reservations on both sides of this sheet of paper, both of them, you know. And I still keep hearing the word, oh, I mean, who can't hear Joe Almeida? And I still hear about that word I've been fighting for years, discretion. So it can be explained, and all, Bob, with great respect, all kind of imaginary issues when cops show up at the scene and do whatever. I think the Department of Health did a great job, and I'm paraphrasing you, my friend, by reaching out and saying, hey, but with these two badges, I got another word for it, but I can't say it here. I thank you.
Good afternoon, Mr. Chairman and members of the House Judiciary Committee. I am testifying today as a former healthcare professional, a former Rhode Island State Senator, and the mother of an adult child who died from substance abuse. Substance abuse is a serious medical disease, not unlike other serious medical diseases, that have a component dealing with lifestyle issues and choices, such as smoking and poor diets, that can contribute to heart disease, diabetes, and certain cancers. For several years as a legislator, I worked on legislation addressing problems associated with opioid use, overdose prevention and treatment, provider education, and reporting systems for prescribers of opioid prescriptions. These initiatives were driven in part by Rhode Island's high rate of opioid use, by the rising rate of overdosing patients and repeat overdosing patients in the state's emergency rooms, and by the number of overdose deaths. Legislation was drafted and enacted in 2012. It was called the Good Samaritan Act. The essence of the Good Samaritan Act was to provide immunity from prosecution for all those who call for help for overdose victims. It was a public health call to help ensure life-saving anti-opioid treatment. House Bill 7003 is modeled after the 2012 measure and also extends the provision of immunity to parole and probation individuals. Many people in the drug user community have had previous drug-related offenses and are likely to be on probation or parole and could be violated and sent to prison if found guilty of another offense. Including immunity for people on probation and parole helps to increase the likelihood of calls to 911 so emergency responders can administer the life-saving medication Narcan. The bill before you this evening is a strong, good, life-saving measure. It is better than the one that we passed in 2012. I sincerely hope the committee will pass this bill and the full House will act on it as soon as possible. In urging your prompt passage of the bill, I also trust that the House will work later in the session to address the one key issue left unresolved by the legislation, and that is extending the immunity provided by the law to cover drug delivery-related charges as well. It is imperative that the law's immunity provisions be clear and unequivocal in order to help ensure that a person calls 911 without hesitation for life-saving help. Because many people experiencing an overdose or who are present at an overdose could still fear being charged with a delivery-related crime, extending immunity to these charges is critical. It is the best way to send an unambiguous message to those in the community that are most at risk that they should not fear picking up the phone. I want to especially thank this evening Representative Craven for his wonderful presentation of the bill initially. I learned from that presentation, and from Chairman Keeble for also being the primary and secondary sponsors of the legislation. And I want to thank the House for taking this bill up so early in the session. It's important that the law is enacted as soon as possible. I want to do everything I can to prevent the loss of another son or daughter or loved one from a drug overdose. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Are there any questions for the senator? Thank you, Senator, for that testimony, which must have been very difficult. And all our hearts go out to you, I'm sure. I speak on behalf of the entire House. Could we hear from Major Dave Lapitin of the Providence Police Department? Major?
Mr. Chairman, while we're waiting for
Representative
Major to take a seat. Major, good to see you. How you doing? I'd like to, in the spirit of Senator Perry's testimony, I think Edith Ajello also deserves. She's carried this ball for a long time. She's the one who actually educated me on the original intent of the law passed in 2012. I'm not sure I would have thought of it on my own. I probably wouldn't. And I think when this law becomes law, I think people owe a great deal of gratitude and a debt of gratitude to you. Thanks.
Yes, absolutely. Major.
Thank you for hearing me. I think it's important to come before the committee to express the police department's feelings, and especially the Providence Police Department, which deals with probably the biggest load of overdoses in the state. You know, we have experienced saving lives with Narcan. Our officers have. And we have also we've also had the opportunity to be called to save lives by a third party. Our feeling is this. We're willing to forego and lose evidence of a possible crime or someone we would arrest to save a life. There's nothing more important than the lives of the people in the state of Rhode Island, city of Providence, around the country. We believe in this bill, and we want it to pass. We've seen the Narcan work. We also believe that Narcan will become so ordinary to police officers, almost like carrying a gun. And they will have it. They will all know how to use it.
I think I was loud enough anyway. So this bill is a fantastic bill for us. And, you know, we've looked and we've seen last year 54 overdoses in the city, I believe.
and, you know, anywhere ranging from, you know, 20 years old to 65. It's funny, the average age we looked at was about 41 years old. This year, we're still going through our numbers, and we'll probably be in the same area. We're still looking at the average age, about 42 years old. So, like I said, we're not... We are totally for this bill. We thank you for listening to us. We are not afraid to lose any evidence against any person if it's going to save a life. All right? Thank you. And I've also had the pleasure of working as a rookie under Joe Almeida when he was with the police department. So I'm very aware of him and thankful that he's on this committee to represent us. So thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you, Major. Are there any questions for the Major? Representative Almeida wants to talk to you one more time.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
I tried to butter him up before he got at me, but...
He's been trying for years. Dave did a good job. I appreciate it. And he, for this committee, he said a few words, if you really listen to what he said, other than what was said here on these two sheets of paper, that my department is willing to forego. I don't see the word forego anywhere in there. It takes a good street cop to make the decision in less than 4 seconds to get something done. And what this committee is looking at right now is a good street cop. And Dave knows, well, I don't like it. I'm going to tell you, I don't like it. But this brother is forthright, and he said the magical words that make me feel more comfortable as I am in support of this bill. But I sure like to see more like Dave up with this. So thank you. You can go now, brother.
Thank you. Thank you, Major. And we have received a letter from the City of Providence under Mayor Alorza's letterhead written by Ellen Sinar, who's here to testify. Ellen, if you want to come up. She's the Director of Healthy Communities Office from the City of Providence. And that letter is in support of the legislation.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman and members of the committee. My name is Ellen Sinar, and I am the director of the City of Providence's Healthy Communities Office. The Healthy Communities Office coordinates the Mayor's Substance Abuse Prevention Council, which is Providence's Municipal Substance Abuse Prevention Task Force. The mission of our task force is to protect youth and prevent harmful substance abuse through evidence-based programs, by building awareness in our community, providing effective education to youth, to parents, and to community members, and supporting comprehensive environmental strategies. While the Healthy Communities Office works on the side of prevention, we see preventing loss of life as a strategy in our work. There are many stories of people who have had another chance at life and are inspired and motivated to make personal behavior changes. The goal is to get more people into recovery. We know that much good work has been done to prevent and reduce overdose deaths and opiate addiction. However, overdose deaths remain a significant problem in the City of Providence and in the state of Rhode Island. In the first quarter of 2014, 28.5% of the overdose deaths in Rhode Island occurred in the City of Providence. The passage of the Good Samaritan Act helped to change the culture in our state and make it more likely that individuals will feel comfortable calling 911 in the case of an emergency overdose, which then leads to lives saved. The Good Samaritan Act was also an important step in encouraging local police departments to have their officers carry naloxone or Narcan. And Providence was one of the first urban departments in the state to take this step following the state police. This has been a positive move for our police officers, who know they're doing the best to help someone, as you heard, and in turn save lives. This act will provide more clarity around those reporting drug overdoses and potential probation violation charges. It also protects those who administer naloxone from liability, including our police force. As such, we believe more lives will be saved, and hopefully more communities in the state of Rhode Island will follow suit. Thank you for your time and support by reinstating and making permanent the Good Samaritan Overdose Protection Act.
Thank you. Any questions? Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Could we hear from Jennifer Carroll from Miriam Hospital and Brown University. I'm going to call up three at a time now, if I can. Brandon Marshall, Dr. Marshall from Brown University, and David Corner from Brown University. Jennifer, you can begin whenever you're ready.
Thank you, Chairman, and thank you to the committee. Good afternoon to everyone. I'm Dr. Jennifer Carroll. I'm a postdoctoral fellow in the Division of Infectious Diseases at Miriam Hospital and a researcher in the Department of Medicine at Brown University. I have been researching substance use and the healthcare decisions, of which the choice to call rescue is one, made by individuals in the context of substance use for nearly a decade. And I've been a member of the harm reduction community for much longer. I'm here today in my capacity not only as a public health scientist and an expert on substance use to implore you to pass this bill in its widest possible protective capacity and pass it permanently, but I also want to share, as a researcher, the testimony of people that I have been talking to through the course of my work. In cooperation with Drs. Tracy Green and Dr. Jody Rich, who's with us today, who are helping to lead the Rhode Island Governor's Overdose Prevention Task Force, I have been actively working with drug users in the Providence area to try to understand why our opiate epidemic looks the way that it looks and to understand the factors that shape people's choices when they are responding to overdose. We heard earlier that 88% of drug users in this city and in this state would be more likely to call 911. If this law were in place. And I can tell you from the work that I was doing even 4 hours ago, actually, I was interviewing someone still, that 4 out of every 5, or more than 80% of the active opiate users that I am talking to in Providence, say that the presence of this bill is absolutely vital to their decision to call 911. And the reason for that is because in the absence of these protections, the citizens of Rhode Island are placed in a dilemma that is not only unethical, but profoundly unfair, because they are forced to weigh their own well-being and livelihood against that of another person. And I don't just want you to take it from me. I have a very short statement from someone who I spoke to only yesterday, a young man in his mid-20s who is a daily heroin user. And this is a quote. When someone is out and overdosing and they're dying, I think, if I stay here, I'm going to jail. And some people have 15, 20 years over their heads because they're on probation, and that is a life. And it's hard because you look at someone's life, and you could leave or not call 911, and they could die. Or you could call, and they could go to the hospital, get out, and then you're in jail doing 4 or 5 years. But with the law there, I would feel better because I wouldn't take off and leave the person, knowing that I'm not going to get in trouble. They're probably going to ask me some questions or whatever, but knowing that I am not going to jail, I could stay right there, I could help them, I could stay with them, at least until help arrived. Okay. We used to think about HIV as a death sentence because it was. But today we have the care and the technology and the capacity to render that kind of thinking obsolete. And HIV-infected people can live long, healthy lives as boring as the rest of us for as long as they want, right? Likewise, we have the tools and the capacity to make accidental opiate overdose survivable, manageable, treatable. And every single overdose death in this state is a failure of our system and us as a community to connect someone in distress with the tools and the care that is probably minutes away that would return them to health and send them home to their families on the same day. And any doubt or any fear in the heart of any citizens of Rhode Island, because these protections are not in place, means that 911 is not going to get called. 911 not getting called means another citizen of the state is going to die, right? The absence of this law is killing your voters. So I encourage you to pass this law and keep it effective. Thank you.
Thank you. Any questions for Dr. Carroll? Thank you.
Hi, everyone. My name is Brandon. I'm an assistant professor in the Department of Epidemiology at the Brown University School of Public Health. I'm also an expert advisor on the governor's overdose prevention and intervention task force and the principal investigator of the Rhode Island Young Adult Prescription Drug Study. As an epidemiologist, I'd like to share some key scientific evidence regarding evidence that Good Samaritan laws, such as the one being considered today, prevent overdose and save lives. Many studies have shown, as Dr. Carroll mentioned, that a fear of police involvement and subsequent arrests are a primary motivating factor for failing to call 911 in the event of an overdose. And Good Samaritan laws represent an effective way to reduce these fears and to encourage bystanders to call emergency services. As the director of BHDDH noted, an evaluation from Washington State found that individuals who witnessed an overdose were more comfortable calling 911 after implementation of their Good Samaritan law. Before coming here today, I analyzed some unpublished data from my own study involving over 180 young adult opioid users here in Rhode Island. The results of this study have shown that over 50% of young people who are using opioids in our state have witnessed an overdose. Moreover, of the 20 respondents who reported recently experiencing an overdose themselves, only 6 stated that a bystander called 911. These findings suggest that many young adults who use opioids in Rhode Island witness overdoses but continue to avoid calling 911 for fear of persecution and subsequent arrest. And therefore, I encourage you to pass this law, which will save lives across our state. In closing, I'd like to emphasize that Rhode Island has the 6th highest rate of fatal drug overdose in the nation, and that's according to a report from the Center for Disease Control published just last December. And the Good Samaritan Overdose Prevention Act is a critical piece of legislation to address this crisis and save lives. And as such, I hope and encourage you to pass House Bill 7003. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Any questions for the witness? Thank you.
I want to thank the committee for allowing me to speak in support of the Good Samaritan Overdose and Prevention Act of 2016. I'd especially like to thank Representative Craven for sponsoring the legislation and applaud the committee for hearing the bill so quickly in the session. I'm a native Rhode Islander and a third-year medical student at Brown, and I plan on continuing to practice as a primary care physician in the state. I've been spending my limited free time as a medical student conducting naloxone trainings at a homeless shelter in the state with the support of PONY, or Preventing Overdose and Naloxone Intervention. And in teaching lay people to respond to opioid overdose, the most critical component we always stress is calling 911, in addition to providing rescue breathing and administering naloxone. The concern that's consistently been raised during these trainings by the participants and the clear barrier towards the use of naloxone is the hesitancy to call 911 and administer naloxone if it may end in an encounter with law enforcement. We strongly encourage participants in the absence of the Good Samaritan law protections to call 911, administer naloxone, and leave the scene before the police arrive if it's a concern. But this leaves a vulnerable individual alone who's overdosing. It leaves paramedics without a valuable witness who could provide information crucial to the appropriate medical management. As a future physician, I'm concerned about this bill and what it means for my patients. And the science is pretty clear. Addiction's a biopsychosocial issue, not strictly a legal one. Just as I don't expect law enforcement to bear the burden of managing my patients with diabetes or hypertension or heart disease, it isn't fair or effective to address the issue of addiction through punitive legal measures alone. I'd instead encourage you to consider, in future laws, providing law enforcement with resources that would enable police to work in partnership with healthcare workers, referring individuals struggling with addiction to recovery and medication-assisted treatment programs. Thank you for allowing me to testify today, and thank you for your time.
Thank you. Any questions? Thank you. Is Jonathan Goyer here? Mr. Goyer, why don't you come up and testify?
I purposely put my name last on the list, but you seem to have skipped ahead.
You can wait if you like.
No, sir. Can you hear me? Oh boy, I didn't have time to think about what I was going to say. My name is Jonathan Goyer. I am a lot of things. I wear a lot of hats. Just going to give you the quick version of my life. 11 years ago, my father passed away from overdose. And 6 years ago, my brother passed away from overdose. And 3 years ago, I was found on the ground, unresponsive, experiencing an overdose. And Narcan saved my life. Thank God I happened to be in an environment where it was a recovery environment where somebody that came across me knew exactly what was happening, and they administered Narcan to me and saved my life. I had never heard of Narcan before that, but I assure you now I make sure everybody knows about Narcan. In the last 3 years of my life, it has been amazing. It is a second chance that I have at life. Fast forward to it nowadays. So I'm a HIV test counselor. I've done a lot of work with HIV prevention. I'm a recovery coach. I went on creditkarma.com like about 8 months ago, and I went and I had like 9 things. My active addiction brought me to some financial burden. Happy to say that 2 months ago I am debt free. Right, I paid off all my debt. I work multiple jobs. I work really hard, and I got an opportunity to clear that up. More importantly, I spent Christmas with my mother a few weeks ago, and that's a woman that lost her only other son and her husband to overdoses, and I was afforded the opportunity to spend Christmas with her and rebuild a relationship that the disease of addiction had taken away from us. I even bought her a computer. She's all on Facebook now. She's tied in. She's tied into the world. I didn't realize that was going to mean I was going to have to be her IT guy every 2 hours calling me, asking me how to work solitaire. So I say all of this because I'm a member of society. I'm a tax-paying member of society who has cleared up my debt. I have gone on to help other people find their recovery. I volunteer. I do Narcan trainings myself. I handed out about 150 kits of Narcan last year with the Merriam Hospital, and I have gotten to see the gift of other people being saved. And to think that this whole year, 3 year period of my life, to think that somebody would be standing over my unresponsive body and have to decide whether or not that's something worth saving is I just can't even comprehend what that somebody has to be put in that situation. Recovery is possible, and I'm an example of that. And getting hit with Narcan, having the EMTs show up, be brought into an emergency room, gain consciousness in a hospital, and something happened to, I'm not sure if anybody here is overdosed or not, but that was a joke. Something happens to you, something happened to me when that opportunity came about. And then as I realized that I had to make a decision, right? That the party was over. It's not getting high anymore. I'm going to be led to jail, or death. And I just died, and I've been granted this opportunity. And through help of recovery supports and supportive friends and family in my life, I've been able to stay on the path of recovery since that day. And I truly believe, being that I came from literally the streets of Providence, living on the streets, doing whatever I had to do to get that next high, if I can change my life around and this bill could potentially provide me an opportunity to do that, I think it's possible for anybody.
Thank you, Jonathan. Thank you for sharing that story with us. I called you up so that we could all see what we're fighting for here today. Yeah. So.
And I just want to say, too, as I'm sitting in the back of the room, no pressure, but as I'm sitting in the back of the room, you know, there's a good chance that as we all sat in here that we just lost another life while we're sitting in this room. You know, and everybody that's in this room, a lot of them have lost lives close to them. And I don't think we need to wait till next week to pass this to the floor. I think we need to pass today.
Thank you very much, Jonathan. Are there any questions for Jonathan? Representative Almeida.
Glad to see you, my brother. I missed a part of that. I was listening to you, but you said you hand out kits at Miriam?
So Miriam Hospital has a program called the PONY program, Preventing Overdose and Naloxone Intervention. It is the only community-based organization that trains and distributes kits of Narcan for free to communities that are unable to obtain it on their own. So we do provide a limited amount of free kits in the community and also encourage people to go to the pharmacy where they can get a kit as well.
Well, how many a week? Just at the hospital and pharmacies, you said?
So we go out into the community wherever it's needed, and we distribute kits and we train. We train anybody who wants to be trained on how to use it.
And you're working with the city of Providence to get that word out?
I don't really work for anybody. I just
go out. Not you, but you as a subject matter, yeah.
We work with whoever calls us and would like a training. We get out there, primarily community-based organizations, nonprofits, and outreach. A lot of organizations are doing outreach.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Thank you. Vice Chair Costa.
Thank you, Chairman. This is a question that the Chairman and I have been discussing. How do you determine who gets the Narcan? How do you determine, when you said you distribute it out through the community, how do you determine who actually gets the kit?
I'll give a kit to whoever wants one. Would you like a kit? I can.
No. I don't think I need one.
Narcan kits should be given to anybody who knows of somebody that uses or that uses themselves, or could potentially be in a situation where they could be around somebody that does use.
So if I knew somebody that was using, I could contact yourself.
Absolutely.
Or I can go to Miriam Hospital and just request it, and it's given to me with no questions answered.
You could do that, or you could also walk into any pharmacy in the state of Rhode Island, any Walgreens or Rite Aid pharmacy, and walk right up to the pharmacist. And thanks to Dr. Jody Rich here, who wrote a prescription for everybody, you can walk right into a pharmacy, and most insurance companies will actually pay for it, and you'll get the intranasal version.
But you need a prescription for that?
No, you do not.
Really? That's interesting. Okay, you just answered a few questions that we've been discussing. And thank you, and good luck on your sobriety. Wish you the best.
Thank you.
Thank you. Any further questions? Yes, Representative McEntee.
Chairman, are you finding that a lot of people are requesting the kits or the prescription, or not a prescription? They are getting them. So people are helping themselves to what they need to.
So being that I train out in the community, I'm just going to tell you my thing. So on average, I set this fun little goal for myself of one kit a day or 30 kits a month that I try to get out in the community. Mm-hmm. Since July 1st, when this bill sunset, I would have given out maybe 100 to 150 kits. Mm-hmm. I've had people turn down wanting kits of Narcan because they weren't covered under this bill, so they refused to accept it, even if they maybe live with somebody or have a significant other that uses opiates.
Because they were concerned about their own liability or their own criminality?
Correct, because currently with no law in state, you're not even covered for liability at mm-hmm. this point. Okay. So we've had people, so in my estimation in my head, there's about 40 less kits of Narcan where they need to be as a result of this bill. And it's really incalculable how many lives that may have
wow.
impacted. But.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Once again, Jonathan, thank you very much for sharing your story, and thank you for all your hard work in the recovery community. It means a lot. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, could we hear from Mike DeLauro from the Public Defender's Office, Steve Brown from the ACLU, and Patrick Quinlan?
Age before beauty, I hope.
We've got three old pros up there, so I'm guessing
really,
you guys can figure it out among yourselves.
I'll be brief. I remember testifying about this bill. It may have been the original version that Senator Perry spoke of. And I remember the week of the hearing, there was an article in the paper about John Bon Jovi's daughter,
who was a college student somewhere in upstate New York, and her life had been saved by virtue of New York's Good Samaritan law. So, you know, we've seen here tonight the faces of this, and they really are. One of the things I would urge the committee to think about is maybe going a little bit further later in the session. I remember after this law was enacted, in my capacity as the training director for my office and the education committee of the Rhode Island Association of Criminal Defense Lawyers, I field a lot of calls and emails all the time. See, people seem to think I know what I'm talking about, I guess. I don't know why they think that. But what I was getting about every 4 to 6 weeks was a lawyer calling me up and saying, the police went to this particular place and they arrested everybody, and I heard about this Good Samaritan thing. How do I use it? So the fact of the matter is that folks were, even after the enactment of this, folks were still getting arrested and charged with this. Now, I don't know what the solution to that is. This is a great first step. I would encourage everybody to support it, but it may need to be tweaked a little later on, I would suggest to you. Be happy to answer any questions you might have.
Thank you. Any questions from Mike? Yes, Representative O'Grady.
Thank you, Mike. Just to pick up on the point that you just raised, so are you suggesting that this bill only applies to the person who's actually making the call? Is that an inference I can make from what you just said? Or
well, I've read it over. It is substantially the same to the law that was sunsetted. I see there is some tweaking that has been done. I think it could go a little bit further. But that being said, this is a tremendous thing if what comes out of this hearing tonight is that we have a law that's going to be on the books forever, that's not going to be subject to sunset provisions. And I think that's a good policy decision to make. Is it perfect? No. But it's a really good start. I hope I answered your question. I didn't.
Any further questions for Michael? Steve?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the committee. On behalf of the ACLU of Rhode Island, I'm here to express our organization's very strong support for this legislation. We especially appreciate the expeditious way in which you're considering this bill. You've already heard extremely compelling testimony about why this is necessary. I do want to follow up on what Mr. DeLauro just said and Representative O'Grady's question. We also agree that there is one missing piece to this bill, at least one missing piece, one key missing piece, and that's one that Senator Perry hit upon, and that's the absence of protection for drug delivery charges. When there's possession of a drug in a place, when there's more than one person at this place where an overdose is occurring, there's a good chance that somebody can fear the charge of drug delivery occurring. So as I think you've heard before, and as you'll hear from other witnesses, one of the key things is trying to have as clear a message, as clean a message as possible, which is you can pick up the phone, you don't have to worry, you are not going to be charged with a drug crime. And I think the absence of protection for delivery doesn't give that message. So we do hope that after you pass this bill, and I know you're going to pass it based on all the comments I've heard, and I really appreciate that, I hope that later this session you will consider making at least one more expansion of the bill to cover this particular issue. Just to briefly address Representative O'Grady's question, the bill does cover both the individual who is experiencing the overdose and the person who calls on their behalf. They both have protection, but it's, again, protection for only these specific drug offenses.
Just to follow
up, Representative O'Grady.
Let's say that there happens to be a third person there who's perhaps using themselves and maybe, you know, not in a state of medical emergency, but, you know, remains when first responders arrive, and maybe they're on probation, or maybe now they're in a situation that would violate them on parole. Are they suddenly, as, you know, innocent bystanders, you know, not covered by their, you know. I know I'm describing a hypothetical, but I'm just.
Yeah, it depends on how you interpret the language in the bill, which talks about anybody who seeks medical assistance on behalf of another. And if two people are in the room and they both say, we were all trying to help this person, I think they're all protected.
Thank you. Any further questions for Steve? Representative McEntee.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'm wondering if the language, Steve, of or the operation of a drug-involved premises may include delivery of the controlled substance or the illegal substance.
I don't believe so. I believe that's a separate delivery is a separate offense from operation of a drug-controlled premise.
But I mean, and the operation of a drug-involved premise infers that there's drugs there and they've been delivered.
But the person who
they're going to be delivered.
The person who allegedly delivers them. So let's assume there are two people using drugs. One of them gets an overdose. The other person calls for help. There isn't an operation of a drug premises, but the police can say somebody gave these drugs to this individual. There's the person who overdosed, and then there's the person who doesn't live there who made the call. Did you deliver these drugs? And at least the attempt can be made to charge that person with delivery, but there is no actual drug-involved operation of a drug-involved premise. So that is our concern.
Thank you.
Any further questions? Thank you. Patrick?
Mr. Chairman, members of the committee, my name is Patrick Quinlan, and I represent a number of groups in the provider community, and I'm here to explain to you that they all support this bill. We supported it last year, I think, in the gap, and I think Jonathan's testimony was very compelling about the demand for naloxone kits during that hiatus period when the law was not in effect. So on behalf of the dentists, oral surgeons, anesthesiologists, radiologists, we all support this, and we'll work with whomever to get the message out to the patients that they work with that this isn't available, because we're assuming you're going to pass this. I would also urge you to pass it as early as you can in the session. If we need to come back or you need to come back and tweak it to cover something else, I think if you save one life by passing it early, I think it's well worth the effort on your part. And thank you to Representative Craven. I did work with him back under Attorney General Moses many years ago. Chairman Keeble, thank you.
Thank you. Any questions for Patrick? Thank you, gentlemen, very much. Could we hear from Rebecca Neves McGoldrick, Laura Bushell, and Alfred Brissett Jr. from House of Hope? Rebecca, I think you're the only one that's here this late into the hearing.
Thank you, members of the committee, and thank you, Chairman Keeble, for taking up this issue so expediently in this session. I will be very brief, as others before me have made very compelling testimony, and I believe I've also become a familiar face to deliver all these facts to you. So, I am the executive director of Protect Families First. One of our issues is overdose prevention, and I am the person who does the overdose prevention trainings within the ACI. So in that training, something that we have run into in years prior is we stress calling 911. However, the concern in every class comes up that people on parole and probation are afraid of receiving violation and being reincarcerated. So I applaud you for considering this bill with the expanded protections for those on parole and probation. I look forward to going back into the prison and delivering encouraging news that says that their lives are as valuable as everyone in this state. And lastly, I would just, as others before me have urged, pass this bill expediently, but we are looking for the full expanded version of this with the delivery charges. As people who go out into the community and tell people to call 911, we want that message to be as simple and clear as possible, as the best public health messages are. Don't smoke, wear a seatbelt, use sunscreen. These are very simple public health messages. We don't want to have to say call 911, however, if, and list off things that are omitted. So it is our hope that you will expand this to its fullest extent possible to make the message as clear as possible to call 911. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you very much, Rebecca. And I did at the beginning of the session promise that we would take this up as quickly as possible, and that promise does still hold. And I thank you very much for your hard work on this important issue. Can I charge you with, can I give you a to-do if you're willing
Absolutely.
To take it? Would you mind taking a look at, see what else is out there among the other states for this delivery issue, the Senator Perry's issue?
Absolutely.
I know your organization's done good research
will,
in the
I
past.
I will do some research on that, and I do believe there are several states that have expanded protections to delivery. As I know the Attorney General has said, you know, 28 states have a Good Samaritan law, but only 15, you know, 15 of those do not expand it to delivery. So I'm assuming that those others, and I will do the research to find those states that do expand it.
Okay, thank you very much, Rebecca. Any questions for Rebecca? Thank you. Could we hear from Dr. Tatoy, Dr. Rich, and Dr. Lewis?
Dr. Rich is here for me.
Very good. Dr. Rich, you've been nominated. And for the record, Laura Bushell from Anchor Community Recovery Center was in favor, as was Alfred Brissett Jr. from the House of Hope. Doctors?
Thank you, Honorable Chair and members of the committee. And I particularly want to thank the both sponsors of this bill. I'm a physician at the Miriam Hospital. I'm also representing the Medical Society. And I've been in Rhode Island for 21 years, and I've seen many, many, many people touched by this epidemic of overdose. And this is an epidemic. When the governor's task force met, Colonel O'Donnell stood up and said, you know, last year we had about 25 murders, homicides in Rhode Island. We had about 50 traffic fatalities, and we had about 250 overdose deaths. This is an epidemic. This is a crisis. This is not. Now, I saw overdose deaths 21 years ago when I got here, and I talked to people who were using drugs, and 50% of them knew someone who had overdosed and died, someone close to them. What's changed is that was a very small group of people, and now we have a very large group. The people that are overdosing and dying are the very tip of the iceberg. This is an epidemic. This is impacting tens of thousands of Rhode Islanders. And so there's not one of us in this room that is not going to be personally impacted by this epidemic if we continue on this trend. So the Colonel O'Donnell said this is a crisis, all hands on deck. This bill has the potential to save lives. And I say potential because we need two things to happen. The first thing we need to do is that person at the overdose, we need them to pick up the phone and call 911, just like anybody would for a heart attack. And they're only going to do that if they have a simple message that's okay. Every drug user knows another drug user. Nobody knows how many drug users there are in the state or any other location, because this is a secret, hidden, stigmatized condition. And in fact, our major approach to this problem, this medical public health problem, has been through the criminal justice system. And that's been a complete failure. We really need a public health approach. We need a medical approach. And we're moving in that direction, thankfully. Every drug user knows another drug user, and it's almost like the game of telephone where you whisper something in someone's ear and they whisper it to the next ear and it goes around. And so there's this network of people, and the word gets out quickly. So the story that somebody, you know, called 911 and the cops show up and the person's laying there turning blue, dying, and the cop says, oh, let me see some ID. Who gave him the drugs? You gave him the drugs. Do business as usual. That is not necessarily the typical thing that happens, but that only has to happen once, or even somebody has to believe that happened once, and that story gets out like wildfire. And so everyone decides we're not going to call. So we have to, now an alternative scenario is the police arrive. They say, what happened? They say he's overdosed. Did you give him some Narcan? Okay, I've got Narcan here. Let's give him Narcan. Let's get him taken care of. And say, thanks a lot for calling. You saved your buddy, and get yourself some help. And here's how to get yourself some help and have a nice day. That kind of interaction can also go through this same network and get out there. So the drug users need to hear that this is the right thing to do, and they need a simple public health message. Law enforcement likewise needs the same message. When you get there, this is your fundamental mission, protect and serve. This is saving a life, and that's really what you should be doing. So we should pass this. I think this bill provides enough to give the simple message to drug users, call 911, the simple message to law enforcement, treat this as the medical emergency it is. And so I thank you all.
Thank you, Doctor. Any questions? Dr. Lewis?
Just to add to my agreement with what Dr. Rich said, and to explain the letter that you've been distributed that came out from the Medical Society, signed by me as the founder of the Brown Center for Alcohol and Addiction Studies, the president of the Medical Society, and John Femineau, who's a specialist in this area. It's actually the letter which asks for some discretion in the period after which the law, you know, was sunsetted, and now is a perfect example of what Representative Craven started with, to talk about the balance between enforcement and treatment and the public health community, and also the issue of discretion, which is where the whole act lies in on the law enforcement side. So if you read the letter, you'll see the point of view that we took as a medical profession and public health professionals, just to illustrate the strength of support for the medical and the public health community, which you also saw today. Also, you heard from somebody who recovered from an overdose, and nothing beats saving a life. Mm-hmm. Nothing beats saving a life, and therefore the message for 911, as Rhoda Perry and others have said, has to be as simple and straightforward as possible. And there have to be very few exceptions. If there's technical violations hanging over your head for parole, probation, some kind of delivery issue, it's not going to work the way it ought to. So the more you can make it a simple message, the more lives you're going to save. So thank you.
Thank you, Doctor. Any questions? Okay, could we hear from Dr. Crowley, Michelle McKenzie, and Mary Furlong, please?
Am I to go first? Okay. Well, thank you, members of the House of Representatives and the General Assembly. I thank all of you for the wonderful service you give to the rest of Rhode Island, and often probably pretty unappreciated, but I certainly appreciate it. And I think I'm here tonight. I'm Dr. James Crowley. I'm pretty much a lifelong resident of Rhode Island. I went to school at LaSalle and Providence College, and I went to Georgetown for medical school. Came back. I eventually became the director of the Cancer Center at Memorial Hospital. So I'm here tonight for a couple of reasons. One is I'm retired now, and I've spent some of that retirement time I've spent working with Michelle and the group from Miriam, and going out As was alluded to earlier, one particularly effective piece of this that I like is the rally, so that there's these rallies that occur, and there are thousands of people, recovering addicts who are not recovered, who hoping somehow they come to the rally, they might get something going for themselves, and then families, the surviving families of overdose victims and people who are just afraid of that, and it hasn't happened to them. And this is where you effectively deliver the Narcan and teach them how to use it. So Narcan, I've known this Narcan, and I just want to sketch it out just briefly. It sounds like it's a brand new miracle drug, but it isn't. I was one of the first physicians to use Narcan when I was an intern at the Boston City Hospital in 1969. So this drug has been around for a while. One might ask, well, if it's been around for a while, how come we've only had these rallies and these efforts to distribute Narcan recently? There have been any prior efforts have pretty much not gone anywhere. In the country now, there's like 180,000 Narcan kits have been distributed by volunteers like Michelle's group, and so I can only say, you know, one has to look at that and say, when the demographics of this disease, heroin addiction and opioid addiction, when the demographics changed, everybody got started to pay attention to it. But I think there was a huge gap between 1969 and the last 5 years in which there many, 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 many died. Now, one thing that I took away then, and I believe it's probably still true, I don't know if it is, but we used to talk to the survivors. We saved about half of them with the Narcan that year, and previously about 95% of them were dead. So that was a big improvement. But when we would talk to them, we'd ask them, were you alone? And most of them would say, no, I was with three or four others, you know, or I was with a couple of guys, it was my buddy, you know. And we said, well, did he call 911? I don't know. You know, he was gone by the time the EMTs got there. So this definitely is a big deterrent for a lot of people. They just don't want to go to prison, and especially the ones on probation that have a job, have reintegrated themselves into the community, and have 9 years more of probation. So they're going to go back to the ACI for maybe 6-7 years. So this is a phenomenal deterrent, and the idea of the delivery, I just would say, it's, again, the balance of the life, as Representative Craven has said. There's no question what's the balance. I mean, gathering some evidence that may or may not result in some kind of prosecution, or may or may not result in a person going to the ACI or being put on probation. I mean, these are all imponderables, and the death is real. Most addicts that I talk to at the rallies will tell me, if they've had an overdose, they'll tell me, that's when I started getting into recovery. That's what prompted me to get into recovery. So you flip that and say, well, if they're dead, there's no recovery, no possibility of it. There's a real possibility. We heard earlier 85% of people brought in the ERs in Rhode Island now are requesting some sort of help to get on the road to recovery. So I just would urge you to pass this law, include the charges of delivery, because that's such a vague thing. If my buddy goes out and I give him, you know, $20 and he gets a hit, brings it back, he's delivering? I don't know. You know, how do you make that distinction? So I think it's better to just have the law clear. As was said many times here earlier, just make it real clear, you know, and that clear message should be, you got to call 911, you got immunity. End of story. Thank you.
Thank you, Doctor. Any questions? Thank you. Mary?
Hi. Am I on?
The button needs to be up.
It's up. Okay. Mr. Chairman and members of the committee, thank you for letting all of us come here and have this opportunity to speak with you. My name is Mary Furlong, and I'm in my second year at Bryant University's Physician Assistant Program, and I'm here on behalf of the Rhode Island Academy of PAs to urge you to pass this bill. The nationwide chapter, the American Academy of Physician Assistants, is support of this bill as well. So I'm here to briefly just urge you to pass it sooner rather than later. Thank you.
Thank you, Mary.
Hi. My name is Michelle McKenzie, and I run the PONY program, which is Preventing Overdose and Naloxone Intervention at the Miriam Hospital. I'm a chair of the Right Cares Board, which is Rhode Island Community for Addiction Recovery Efforts, and serve on the Governor's Task Force for Overdose Prevention and Rescue. And I want to thank the committee very much for bringing this at the very this bill at the very beginning of the session. I think it's very important that we rectify the lack of having a good SAM bill and pass it as soon as possible. And so support passing this bill as it exists. Thank you, Representative Craven. I guess I also request that we come back after passing it and tweak it, as Mike DeLauro said and Steve Brown said and Senator Perry asked for. It's in the lack of, I'd like to reiterate that the message, the public health message, needs to be very clear. And though this law is improved upon the 2012 Good Sam version because it includes protections for people who are on probation and parole, and as Rebecca McGoldrick testified, Pony, as part of Pony, she is doing weekly, is in the prison in all of the different facilities talking to people about overdose prevention. And the fact that she can now say you are protected is really important. But likewise, when we're in the community, and there's 12 Pony volunteers, we have worked with over 30 community groups in the last 12 months. In 2015, we distributed over 800 naloxone kits. And with regard to, since 2012, we've distributed almost 2,000 kits. So I think that the 2012 Good Sam version was very good in letting people know that they were protected to carry naloxone and to use naloxone in the case of an opioid overdose. But in doing our trainings in, as I said, a variety of different community settings, and many of those trainings are with people who have a criminal justice background, the information that I'm hearing back from them is that they're still afraid to call 911. And the 2012 law was good. It was really a good first step, but it was just not enough. Because if you think about it, we've had 40 years of a drug policy of sending people to jail for using drugs and possessing drugs. And so as we make inroads into changing and creating a public health infrastructure so that that we address drug use and addiction from a public health point of view instead of a criminal justice point of view, it's going to take time to really have people believe that message. And it's easier to believe that message when it's really clear. And that would include expanding protections as much as possible, including delivery. So protecting people from delivery prosecution if they call 911 to save a life. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Michelle. Any questions? Thank you. Could we hear from Barbara Thomas, Jackie LaValle, and my constituent, Tony Charpentier? Thank you, ladies, for your patience this evening. We appreciate it. There was quite a few people here to testify. Can begin. Whoever would like can start. Make sure the button's up.
Hi, my name is Toni Charpentier, and I am from Barreville. I'm also actively pursuing a recovery coach training. So I'm fairly new to the Narcan, but I was trained in it recently at our recovery center. And like everybody else in Rhode Island, I do know people who have been touched by this epidemic. And I think it's imperative that people do not fear negative repercussions for calling 911. So I am totally in favor of this bill. And as I stated, I know people that have had overdose and been saved by Narcan personally. So I am definitely in favor of this bill. Thank you.
Thank you. Yes, and in town, we're certainly struggling with it.
Yes, Barreville has an epidemic.
Yes, we do.
Excuse me. Yes, my name is Barbara Thomas, and I am a person in long-term recovery. I also am currently pursuing my career in this field. I also was a part of that Pony program, being the one to receive the Narcan in case of emergency. And I also am pursuing my goal into the recovery peer specialist program. So I would pray and hope that this bill gets passed rather sooner than later. And like I said, like, we don't want to lose any more lives. You know, I don't know where I would be, you know, from 23 years ago. Like, you know, that could be me. So with that being said, please pass this bill tonight.
Thank you, Barbara. Good luck, and thank you for being here.
I'm Jackie LaValle. My biggest concern about this bill, everybody's talking about people being on probation and stuff. I'm a person in long-term recovery that I have time, and I don't have a criminal record. I got lucky, okay? I didn't get expunged or anything. I just happened to be in the right place at the right time. My dad was a sheriff in Massachusetts. But anyways, my biggest concern is getting into this field, and I want to do social work. I want to get involved with DCYF. If I walk into a person's house and they've got narcotics or whatever paraphernalia around the house, I don't want to get in trouble with it. I've been certified. I took the orientation class to get it, but I'm afraid to use it. I'm afraid that I'm going to get charges for helping somebody else. You know what I mean? Because you're in the wrong place at the wrong time. I've seen it 1,000 times around here, in and out of the halls. Please pass this, please.
Thank you, Jackie. Thank you, ladies. Thank you for waiting so long in the evening, too. I believe we have two more witnesses signed up to testify. Leanne Brine from the Rhode Island Coalition for the Homeless and Elise Reynolds. Is Elise still here?
Thank you, Chairman and members of the committee. Appreciate you all being here. And of course, reiterate the graciousness of many of the people that testified before me on your quick action on this legislation. I'm Leanne Byrne. I'm the policy director at the Rhode Island Coalition for the Homeless. I'm also a social worker, and because I know that many of my constituents and also people that I'm friends with personally are people in recovery, I carry naloxone. The Coalition for the Homeless is very grateful to have this legislation before you today to rapidly reinstate the protections of the Good Samaritan Overdose Prevention Act and to make these protections permanent. We're in strong support of the legislation. We are very glad to see the expansion to the protections for people on probation and parole as well. For our constituents for whom addiction history applies, the risk of opiate overdose is very high. As you know, addiction is a chronic relapsing disease, and individuals experiencing homelessness may use drugs or alcohol to self-medicate during a time of trauma in their lives. They're also at high risk of overdose due to the periods of abstinence that they may go through while they're in prison or staying at shelters that require sobriety. The protections of the Good Samaritan Overdose Prevention Act are essential to our providers and to our constituents to administer life-saving assistance of naloxone and to seek medical help. This fall, Lawton Parker, a guest at Harrington Hall, administered naloxone to another guest he found who had passed out and was unconscious on the floor of a restroom in the hall. Lawton had been trained because he is a peer mentor at Harrington Hall in overdose prevention and naloxone administration. The skills that Lawton learned in this program and the empowerment that he has gained from now saving the life of a fellow person experiencing homelessness will be key in him accomplishing his goals of finding employment and getting an apartment. We know that there are many men that stay in that shelter and other member agencies across the state each day who are struggling with the same things that Lawton had and also the individual that he saved. We know that recovery is possible, and we hope that for all of our constituents. But your assistance is necessary to protect them and our providers along the way. So we appreciate your help, and I'm always happy to take any questions.
Thank you. Any questions for Leanne? Thank you.
Oh, that's up. Oh, there you go. Hi, I'm Elise Reynolds. I'm a nurse. I worked in methadone for many years. I've lost two sons to overdose, and I really believe that my first child, that if this was in effect at that time, I believe that he'd still be here with us. He would have had another chance. This Narcan is very, very important. Just think of it if it was in your family. Possibly is. Some people don't realize that this addiction really takes on so many lives. So I'm just asking to please help to pass this as soon as possible.
Thank you very much. Thank you. And very sorry for your loss. Thank you. Also signed up today, all in favor of the bill, but not speaking, are George O'Toole from Anchor Recovery. My constituent, Michelle Hartner, also from Anchor, who I'm certain will hound me until this bill is passed without any question. Jen Paolo from Kodak, also in favor. The Rhode Island State Nurses Association signed up in favor of the bill, as did Obed Papp on behalf of the City of Providence, and Amy Forrest from Anchor. We did receive numerous correspondence, most of which was mentioned during the course of the hearing. Also, Karen Griffin from Greenville sent a letter in support of the legislation. Ellen Sinar on the Mayor Alawz's letterhead sent a letter in favor. We received a letter from the State Police and the Attorney General, Director Montanaro, Michelle McKenzie, who also testified, Leanne Bryan, and the Rhode Island Coalition for the Homeless. Rhode Island Medical Society also sent a letter.